So as you mentioned, it was back in 1963 that the vaccine came out. And actually in 2000, the disease was actually considered for the most part eradicated. Why are we writing a book about this now? And why are we worried about this now?
So I'm going to draw one distinction that is going to seem semantic, you know, and maybe even pedantic, but is important, and that's the distinction between eradication and elimination. And so we eradicated smallpox. So that means that there is no smallpox anywhere in the world. No one needs to get vaccinated against smallpox anymore. Like, it's not part of the routine vaccine schedule. It's been eradicated from the world.
Okay. Elimination
is different, and it's much more tenuous. 2000, the CDC and the World Health Organization certified the United States as being measles-free, as having achieved measles elimination. And there's a technical definition behind that, you know, no locally acquired cases within two generations of importation for a 12-month period. You know, like there's a definition for it, but basically what it means is no ongoing spread of measles in the population for over a year. The problem with elimination as opposed to eradication is that there's still measles elsewhere in the world. Okay. And if you have someone who gets on a plane and comes to the U.S., or you have someone, you know, from the U.S. who's not vaccinated, who goes somewhere where there's measles spreading, and then they come home, they bring measles with them. And so elimination is a situation where you have to be vigilant. Everyone still has to be vaccinated. You know, because measles is so contagious, we need 95% or more of the population vaccinated, because there's always the chance of reintroduction. And that's something we see frequently. So that's a long-winded intro to the question of why write a
why
book
now?
About measles now. So the reason is, you know, A, measles is a perennial threat and will be, you know, for as long as it's not eradicated. B, we're seeing a global, not just a U.S., but a global resurgence of vaccine-preventable diseases. And as we talked about a couple of minutes ago, measles is often first. And we've seen that. We've seen in the last year a significant increase in measles worldwide, about 100,000 deaths worldwide from measles, mostly in children. That's way down from before we had a vaccine, like way, way down, but still is 100,000 people who died of a preventable disease. And because measles is this combination of incredibly contagious and eminently vaccine preventable, it provides us that early warning. So I think the measles story is worth telling and worth thinking about for that reason. Not in spite of the fact that we have a vaccine to prevent it, but because we have a vaccine to prevent it. Because we have that, it shows us the holes in our systems.
All right. And it really, it isn't hypothetical if we look back to 2019 in New York.
Yeah, it didn't. It certainly didn't feel hypothetical at that point. Yeah, so there was an outbreak that took place in two places, in New York City, where most of the cases were, and then in Rockland County, which is north of the city. And we had between 600 and 700 cases in New York, and it was the initial cases were seeded by an unvaccinated person returning from international travel, which is often how it goes. And the reason that there was sustained spread was that within a relatively cloistered community, there was a much lower rate of vaccination than we needed to prevent measles spread. So in the city as a whole, like, if you just looked at the statistics for New York City in 2018, yeah, somewhere between 95% and 98% of kindergartners had, you know, their MMR vaccines up to date. I would have glossed right over New York City. I would have been like, okay, they're good. Let's see where else to focus on. But the problem is that rates at the level of cities or counties or states can miss pockets of under vaccination. And so in this case, the community in which that child returned to had about a 60 or 70% MMR vaccination rate. And that is enough for measles to spread and to pick up speed. And that, you know, and the story of that outbreak goes back, you know, a decade or two prior, where that's a community that that used to have high rates of vaccination. And over time, due to a number of issues, there was specific targeting of the community by the anti-vaccine group and an erosion of trust in public health.
Well, one of the arguments that comes up of people that have chosen not to vaccinate themselves or their children is, well, that's a personal choice. And you're making the case quite eloquently that it's not really a personal choice because of the extraordinary ability for this disease to infect so many other people. It is a community choice.
Yeah, I mean, it's very hard because we're a country and, you know, a people who value personal choice, and that's important. But I think that for most of us, I would argue maybe for almost all of us, there are times where you give up personal choice or you tailor your personal choice to provide benefit to the people around you. And, you know, yes, if you get vaccinated against measles yourself, you're probably protected. There's a primary vaccine failure rate for the measles vaccine of about 5%, and if you get two doses, that's about 3%. Meaning that if you appropriately vaccinate 100 people, you have three of them who are still susceptible to measles. If you vaccinate everybody, that's fine. That's not enough people to have measles continue to spread in the population. But if you have a lot of people opting out and you have that situation where not everybody is protected and you have people who can't get the vaccine, like we right. don't give it until about a year of age, first of all. So everyone under a year is yep. susceptible. And then you have, you know, kids or adults who are getting chemotherapy or who've had an organ transplant or something like that. The measles vaccine is a live attenuated vaccine that we don't give to immunocompromised people. And so there's this built-in susceptible population that you can't avoid. And the way that we avoid that is by vaccinating as much of the population as we can.
Okay. And there is the perception that if you've been vaccinated or you've had measles, you're likely not to get it again. But the question that really starts coming up, and I think the New York Times just ran an article recently that really talked about adults being of higher risk for developing diseases. That really shouldn't provide that much comfort.
Yeah, I mean, I think that most people who are appropriately vaccinated have lifelong immunity against measles. That's not true for everything, and it's not 100% true for measles. Like, measles immunity can wane. It's more of a problem for some other diseases. So the second M in MMR is mumps, and yeah. mumps immunity after vaccination wanes over time. And so we see this in college age students. There are outbreaks of mumps on college campuses, and often those outbreaks involve kids who've gotten either one or two doses of the MMR vaccine. And actually, that's a talking point that's picked up on by the anti-vaccine folks a lot. They're like, see, the vaccine doesn't work. And the problem with that, you know, way of thinking about things is if you have a population that is 99% vaccinated, and you have some waning of immunity or some primary vaccine failure, and then you have a contagious disease that comes in, you would expect, even if the vaccine works really, really well, like 95% of the time, you would still expect a higher number of cases in the vaccinated group than you would in the unvaccinated group. It's just when you look at the rate, denominators are important. When you look at the rate, you would see that a higher percentage of the non-vaccinated people would get the disease. So it makes for confusion that way. So, you know, for mumps, for measles, these vaccines work. They provide good and durable protection. For mumps specifically, sometimes there's a need in the setting of an outbreak for a third dose to provide a boost for protection.